Everyone, please stand, please. Thank you.
Academy one, three quarter, right face, turn. Cover. Please join us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Right hand over your heart. Ready, begin.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Academy one, quarter right, turn. Take a seat.
Well, good evening, and welcome to Mt. San Antonio College. My name is Ray Mozak. I'm the Director of Public Safety Programs here at Mt. San Antonio College. It is a privilege to be here with you tonight for the graduation of the first Mt. San Antonio College Wildland Fire Academy. Before we begin, I would like to recognize a few people in attendance tonight. Will all active or retired members of the military please stand to be recognized? Thank you for your service. Will all active or retired members of fire, police, and EMS services please stand to be recognized? Thank you for your service. From Mt. San Antonio College, I would like to recognize the following individuals. Our Dean of Technology and Health, Lance Hurd. Our Associate Dean of Tech and Health, Sarah Pleasants. I want to go off script here for a minute and talk about Sarah real quick. This is her first and last Wildland Fire Academy graduation, so she'll be retiring in June. Throughout my time here, she has been nothing but a supporter of all our programs, specifically public safety programs, and she was instrumental in getting the resources and funding to actually put this program in place. So thank you very much, Sarah. Also like to introduce our student trustee, Cesar Alvarado. So, as a Wildfire Academy, we have some representatives of the U.S. Forest Service I'd like to introduce. First, Chief Jaime Gamboa, U.S. Forest Service Region 5 Director. Chief Jay Kurth, U.S. Forest Service Region 5 Deputy Director. Chief Matt Kurth, U.S. Forest Service Region 5 Assistant Director. Chief Dave Updike, U.S. Forest Service National Headquarters, Washington, D.C. Incident Management Organization. Chief Updike is also one of our wildland professors. Chief Scott Atkinson, our Assistant Director of Public Safety Programs. Fire Technology Professors, Richard Genovese. Fire Technology Professor, Ed Valdez. Our Wildland Fire Technology Professors, Chief Brandon Burrell. And our Wildland Fire Technology Professor, Arnold Ramirez. I also want to introduce the college president and CEO, Dr. Martha Garcia. Our our Fire Academy fitness instructor, Jabari Morris. So behind any program here at Mt. SAC, there are people behind the scenes who work hard to put the pieces together to ensure student success. I would like to recognize three individuals tonight. Without them, our programs would not be successful. Fire Technology Tool Technician, Stephen Benson. Administrative Specialist 2, Tracy Chen. Administrative Specialist 4, Michelle Navarro. These individuals are the backbone of public safety programs. Without them, we could not effectively run our programs. I truly appreciate their hard work and dedication. Please join me in recognizing them once more. Thank you. Now I would like to call up the Battalion Chief for the 1st Wildland Fire Academy, Samuel Dominguez.
Hello, everybody. My name is Samuel Dominguez. I am Wildland Academy 1 Battalion Chief. I have a little speech for everybody. So, good afternoon, everyone, family, friends, chiefs, and most importantly, Wildland Academy 1. Today, we're here to celebrate a small victory in a lifetime full of battles. I would like to open with a quote from Marcus Aurelius, an ancient Roman philosopher. It says, "Your principles cannot be extinguished unless you snuff out the thoughts that feed them. For it's continually in your power to reignite new ones. It's possible to start living again. See things anew as you once did. That is how to restart life." Before this academy, never did I ever think I was going to be a firefighter, let alone have a position of authority within this academy. I am truly thankful for the opportunity and education this academy has given me. Academy 1 has been the most fun, most stressful, and most insightful time, I think, for any of us, or at least it was for me. I remember showing up on the first day of the academy, looking around and thinking to myself, man, we got a lot of work to do, especially after going on our first hike together. And even after all the training and hiking and cutting line, I know all of us at one point asked ourselves, geez, what did I sign up for? But as I look around, looking at my brothers and my sisters, I think we can all agree that we signed up for a job that takes mental toughness, strength, and grit. And for that, I couldn't be any more proud. This is the start of a new journey, a journey that for some will be the only one they know, and for others, a journey that will open up so much opportunity. I want to thank Chief Burrell, Chief Mozak, and all the instructors and staff for making this academy possible. Thank you, Mom, thank you, Dad, and thank you to the moms and dads of the men and women in this academy. Without your support and love, we wouldn't have been able to do it. And thank you, Academy 1. I look around at all of you and smile because I know I can call you all my family, my brothers and my sisters. And as I close, I want to leave you with one last quote. One person on doing well by others immediately accounts the expected favor in return. Another is not so quick, but still considers the person a debtor and knows the favor. A third kind of person acts as if not conscious of the deed, rather like a vine producing a cluster of grapes without making further demands, like a horse after its race, or a dog after its walk, or a bee after making its honey. Such a person, having done a good deed, won't go shouting from the rooftops, but simply moves on to the next deed, just like the vine produces another bunch of grapes in the right season. We do this job not for the accolades or for the thank yous. We do this job not because we want to be on Channel 5 News. We do this job because we care, because we want to achieve something bigger than ourselves. So with all that said and done, the only thing left to do is throw my hands up, shrug my shoulders, and say, Academy 1. Thank you.
Thank you. Well said. What's probably more impressive than the speech is the fact you're reading from your phone, and I'm reading from pages with 50-point font on them. Impressive. All right, now I would like to introduce our keynote speaker for this evening, Chief Brandon Burrell. Chief Burrell is a battalion chief working out of the Los Angeles National Forest, and has 22 years with the U.S. Forest Service. In those 22 years, he has held the following positions: hotshot, engineer, engine captain, forest fire planner, forest training officer, prevention BC, and acting deputy chief. In addition, Chief Burrell has been an adjunct professor at Mt. SAC for the past 13 years, teaching wildland fire classes. Please join me in welcoming Chief Burrell.
Well, there will definitely be some themes shared between Sam and I tonight. And I lost page one, so that will be an interesting start. Oh, good news, I found it. I'm very grateful for the chance to speak with you here tonight. And you'll have to cut me a little slack. I am way more comfortable around bushes and trees than 300 people. But I'll do my best to get through what we do. Before I do, however, I would like to mention how encouraged I am by the overwhelming amount of support in this room. When we started planning for this in the classroom and we started talking about the tickets that each student would need, the numbers were amazing to me. And I thought, wow, you guys really, incredible. So I think it's worth saying that the men and women who sit in the front two rows here, they are embarking on a very exciting journey to new careers that will be rewarding, challenging, and their success, as Sam already said, will depend on the support of you, their loved ones, their family. So stick with them. I would also like to offer this group of people a sincere compliment. And if your students have been telling you anything about me, sincere compliments are not my default. So that's how you know it's sincere. The families represented in this room have done an outstanding job at raising, mentoring, disciplining, and preparing these students for what they're doing here. They consistently throughout this academy have shown the highest level of our core values: duty, integrity, and respect. And that's not something they learned here. I didn't teach them that. They didn't get that from this college. They came here with that. So I thank all of you again for preparing them for what we've done here. It's been phenomenal. So let's see. Oh, one of the students asked me recently what my first impression was when we started this academy. And I didn't give him a very good answer, and I'm not finding him yet. Now I've got him. I didn't give him a very good answer, so I'd like to take this opportunity to do it publicly so everybody can hear. Yeah, right? That would be good. So let me be honest. Day one of this academy, I saw exactly what I thought I would see. I saw a bunch of young kids, not quite as old as my work boots, who were telling me that they had experience fighting fire on Minecraft, and I should try it because it was very realistic. It was great. True story. And they promised me a demo, which I quite frankly have yet to see. But I only saw that for a moment, because what I quickly recognized was that this is an incredibly diverse group of men and women that represent several generations who came together in this academy to create something great. And that was impressive to me. We shared many encouraging quotes over the last 12 weeks. But there's one that sticks with me, and I think I'm the one who started it, so I guess it would make sense. But it comes from Proverbs 27:17. Iron sharpens iron, so one person sharpens another. I have watched the 29 of you for the last 12 weeks sharpen each other. Some in physical skills, some in emotional skills, some in well, everything else we did. But I am definitely sharper for having spent time with your family. They improved me. As a matter of fact, I will even say they have permanently changed my outlook of Generation Z. Let me openly admit to you, when I saw this age group in front of me, I thought, oh, here we go. These are some of the hardest working men and women, regardless of age, that I have stood next to in a really long time. And they represented well, so your generation should thank you. I doubt they will because they're on video games somewhere. But, okay, now I had better start getting to the point. So everybody knows I'm a talker, right? Comms has me on a timer already. So for the last time in this academy, comms, bear with me. I'm gonna get to the point. It'll just take a couple of minutes. When I prepared what I wanted to say here tonight, it was very difficult. I am very passionate about wildland fire. It is my job, but it is great. The things the government pays me to go out and do, phenomenal. So the things I wanted to share with you, when it really came down to it, it wasn't a quick 6 or 7 minute speech. It was gonna take me about 3 hours every Wednesday for about 8 weeks. And I was quickly shut down on that idea. They suggested that you'd have to pay for that class. So instead, I thought I would just share a little perspective from my years of experience. So I've heard a lot of things over the years about wildland fires and the people who fight them. I've heard government leaders say we should be out in the forest raking leaves to prevent wildfires. Some of you might have heard that too. And that might represent forests somewhere near Washington, D.C., but it greatly underestimates the work that needs to be done nationally. I have also heard leaders refer to wildland firefighters as unskilled labor. And I've learned to take that in stride because I know the truth. And here we go. Anyone can fight fire in a box. Try fighting fire when the whole world is your workspace. That's a whole different thing. And if you're offended by that, I apologize. That's a joke for my municipal friends. And I have a few municipal friends, not a lot. So in my career, I've seen a change in fires, in fire season, in the dynamics of fire, and certainly in size. When I started this career, a 100,000-acre fire was significant. That was something to take note of. And now, 20-some-odd years later, that number is at 1 million acres. So the 100,000-acre fires aren't so notable anymore. 2020 is on record as California's worst fire season and saw a record of 4,300,000 acres burned in the state alone. 2021 saw a single fire reach just shy of 1 million acres. It was 980,000, which is significant. And if you've been watching this year, the state of Texas has already passed 1 million acres burned, and we're only in the month of April. And it's worth noting that this is not just a problem in the United States. Australia, Canada, Greece, Spain, all seeing million-acre fires and massive amounts of devastation. One of the additional things that I've heard in my career is that fires are so big because we have mismanaged lands. And that one isn't so far off. It's just perspective that needs to be understood there. So, and I know you guys, starting to sound like classroom. I know, it's over, I promise. A couple more minutes. I can't help myself, y'all know that. So, it all comes down to the culture of the times in our history. In 1910, after a series of devastating wildfires, the federal government enacted a policy to extinguish all fires upon initial attack, keep them as small as possible. This was done to protect communities and timber revenues, and it made sense. It made really good sense. Given the population and the tools they had available, that was their option. That's actually what led, I thought I'd throw a fun fact in there, maybe just fun for me, that's what led to the development of Smokey Bear in 1944 to raise public awareness of wildfire and the hazards associated with. Fast forward a bit to the late 1960s, when a change in culture prompted us to look at fire's role on the landscape and what should be occurring naturally. This led to a slight and short-lived change in policy in 1971 to what was called the 10 a.m. policy that said all fires would be held to less than 10 acres. And that lived for a very short period of time, a few more devastating fires, and we abandoned that, went right back to trying to put fires out as small as possible. All the while, our forests continue to grow and become more dense. So a couple more stats, I'll keep them brief. In 1994, it was the first ever comprehensive interagency review of wildland policy. So that's interagency. We were looking at everybody who could help. In 2014, a cohesive strategy was in place for a multi-agency framework focused on landscapes, communities, and fire response. So the picture was starting to widen. Now in 2024, the U.S. government has implemented the Wildfire Crisis Strategy. And that is to fund and organize new ways of prepping for and dealing with wildland fires, and funding them, obviously. So I don't share all of that because I think anybody's particularly interested, but I want that to be the framework that helps you encourage these men and women in these careers. Perhaps in 1910, there was an accurate view of pulling people out of bars, putting them in a truck, and go fighting a wildland fire. That could have been true. But that is absolutely not a picture of what fighting a wildland fire looks like today. We are finally keeping up with the knowledge and science of wildland fire. Today's workforce is developing technical skills and knowledge of wildfires that is unmatched in history. These students will have opportunities and experience unknown to generations before them. They're only going to be limited. You guys know what I'm going to say you're limited by, right? Only limited by your effort and desire. It's the only thing that will limit you in the career that's in front of you. So please enjoy their careers with them. Support them. They have great places to go. And none of us yet knows where they'll end, but this is a fantastic path you guys are starting. So comms, I know. I got it. So give me just one more minute. So you guys think I'm joking. He is duty bound to call me out. So I have to be concise here. Academy One, when we started out, we started out to create a team, right? We started out to set some ground rules for what Academy Two will follow up to and every academy that follows that. And I want you guys to know from me very directly that you exceeded every expectation I could possibly have put on this academy. You guys have set a standard. I might have to just quit because I don't know how we beat this. You guys have set a phenomenal standard. So throughout your career, you guys will be part of some really exceptional teams. But every team you're a part of from this point forward will be measured against this one. So I want to give you the last piece of encouragement I give you as a group. This is your legacy. Honor it. I will. And thank you for letting me be a part of your team. This was a cool experience. So, last words I have for you. You ready? We are Academy One. Thank you.
Thank you, Chief Burrell. Chief Burrell, like I said, has been here for 13 years. We had only one wildland fire technology class. Now we have five core classes along with other curriculum and our first fire academy. And Chief Burrell has been here since I think 3 years ago when we started planning for this. So thank you very much. Very well said. All right. So during the first week of the academy, trainees are given the opportunity to compete for leadership positions. The process includes submitting a resume and participating in oral interview, much like you would for a job out there in the fire service. At the end of the process, the Academy BC, company captains, a few other critical support function positions are filled, and the following individuals served in these roles during the academy. Academy Battalion Chief Samuel Dominguez. Captain of Company 1, Zachary Cordova. Captain of Company 3, Tiffany Farina. Captain of Company 4, Julian Tesoro. Lieutenant, Company 1, Nicholas Kefalis. Lieutenant, Company 2, Seth Rodriguez. Lieutenant, Company 3, Manuel Munoz. Lieutenant, Company 4, Zane Alvarez. Our AV technicians, Jeffrey Carbonell and Jason Huff. Logistics Officer, Kayla Glenn. Thank you. Okay, apparently my math is off today. Captain for Company 2, Jeffrey Carbonell. Our logistics officer, Kayla Glenn. Oh, I already did it. I got the big fonts too, I'm telling you, and glasses. All right, tool technician, haven't done that yet, right? Okay, tool technician, Jacob Nessel. Okay, now our top company. Wildland firefighters rely on each other and work as a team to accomplish their mission and ensure the safety of all members of their crew. During the Wildland Academy, there's a friendly competition amongst the assigned companies. There are four companies. Each week, the companies are evaluated and scored on uniform inspection, individual academics, and effective behavior. The top company of the week is then given a star to wear on their uniform, and the company is posted in the hallway outside the classroom. At the end of 12 weeks, the company with the most top company awards then becomes the overall top company for the academy. So the overall top company for class one was Company 3. Could I have all the members come up on stage to receive their award? Tiffany Farina, Kayla Glenn, Dylan Lopez, Samuel Munoz, Kimberly Sedania, Nathan Fragoso, Jacob Mutka, Mason Kadowski. So as the top company for the first Fire Academy, their names will be memorialized on the wall outside the classroom. Congratulations. Now we're going to go some more specific awards. The first one is for honor student. During the Wildland Fire Academy, the trainees take several written exams and manipulative exams. They earn 14 different professional certifications over a 12-week period. Out of the total of 406 possible points, this trainee had a total score of 397. Trainee Bryce Hillman. Most inspirational award. This trainee has grown over the 12 weeks and has demonstrated the ability to become an inspirational leader. He is a shining example of what a firefighter should be. His fellow trainees have described him as driven, resilient, and focused, and he's always willing to help others. His drive and attention to detail is contagious and stands to serve as an example for everyone to follow. This trainee proved to himself and others that failure is not an option and that he could succeed with hard work and perseverance and be a true leader who inspires others. Trainee Donovan Valenzuela. Now for the Chief's Award. This trainee epitomizes heart, perseverance, and dedication. Academy instructors have described him as nice, humble, and a true leader and all-around good person. His fellow trainees have described him as having a strong work ethic and goal-driven, and he knows how to lead. Other trainees looked up to him and went to him for advice and guidance throughout the academy. His fellow trainees admired his ability to remain calm under pressure and his attention to detail. His character and work ethic exemplify what it is to be a servant leader, a desirable trait that fire chiefs look at for potential candidates. This trainee serves as an inspiration to me and to the academy for demonstrating what it takes to get the job done, put others first, be humble, and lead by example. Trainee Samuel Munoz. Now I'm going to ask Chief Axton to come to the podium because we're going to award the certificates for the Academy, followed by the oath of office.
Academy, attention! Upright fighters! Move out!
Chief Updike, Chief Ramirez, would you be willing to come up on stage to hand out certificates, please? Thank you. You guys got to squeeze in. All right. Well, thank you very much for coming tonight to our ceremony, and this is one of the more important events where we're going to award the certificate to each of our students. First student up is our battalion chief, Samuel Dominguez. Zachary Cordova. Nico Kefalis. Brian Earwood. Jacob Gonzalez. Bryce Hillman. Dagoberto Lopez. Jeffrey Carbono. Ryan Reglado. Anthony Bach. Yeah! Owen Freaking. Jacob Nessel. Seth Rodriguez. Donovan Venezuela. Tiffany Farina. Kayla Glenn. Dylan Lopez. Samuel Munoz. Kimberly Saldano. Nathan Fragoso. Jacob Muttcut. Mason Gutotsky. Julian Tercello. Zane Alvarez. Vincent Contreras. Sebastian Cox. Jason Huff. Johan Munoz. Christopher Solis. Now, for the administration of the honorary oath of honorary oath of office. Would everybody please raise your right hand? Would you then repeat after me? I,
Samuel Dominguez,
Zachary Cordova,
Nico Cafales,
Brian Earwood,
Jacob Gonzalez,
Bryce Oman,
Alberto Lopez,
Jeffrey Carbonell,
Ryan Regalado,
Anthony Bach,
Owen Frackin,
Jacob Nessel,
Seth Rodriguez,
Donovan Valenzuela,
Christopher Solis,
Johan Munoz,
Jason Hopp,
Sebastian Cox,
Vincent Contreras,
Zane Alvarez,
Julian Tesoro,
Mason Katowski,
Jacob Mutka,
Nathan Fragoso,
Kimberly Cedeno,
Samuel Munoz,
Dylan Lopez,
Kayla Glenn,
Tiffany Farina.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
To do my duty as a firefighter.
To do my duty as a firefighter.
To the best of my ability.
To the best of my ability.
To serve my commanding officers.
To serve my commanding officers.
With respect and dignity.
With respect and dignity.
To serve the citizens.
To serve the citizens.
With compassion.
With compassion.
Courage.
Courage.
And integrity.
And integrity.
And to uphold the laws and the constitutions.
And to uphold the laws and constitutions.
Of the United States of America.
Of the United States of America.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations, you may be seated.
Okay, so over the last 12 weeks, these trainees have been leaving home before sunrise and returning in the early evening. The following video will give you a glimpse of what their days at the academy have been like and why they came home exhausted and probably not smelling so great.
Thank you.
Okay, before we get into closing remarks, I want to just emphasize what it takes to put one of these programs on from its inception to the execution to graduating our first class here. We were very fortunate. We were able to start this program with grant funding through our strong workforce grant program and the support from the board or the school board and president CEO down to the dean, down to the instructors, and certainly the staff, and definitely the support of our partners for the U.S. Forest Service. So thank you very much. A little side note, all that equipment you saw there was brand new, again, paid for by the grants, but we also just found out that we were approved for congressional funding of over $500,000 for additional equipment. So we have a lot more academies coming. All right, to the graduates of the Mt. SAC First Wildland Fire Academy, congratulations are in order. Your journey over the past 12 weeks has been nothing short but remarkable, and I couldn't be prouder of each and every one of you. Throughout this academy, you have faced grueling physical challenges, endured long hours of training, and tackled demanding tasks in the wilderness. Your resilience and determination deserve commendation. What began as a gathering of strangers has transformed into a tight-knit family of 29 individuals bonded by friendship, camaraderie, and mutual trust. The academy experience will forever hold a special place in your hearts. Undoubtedly, the academy has left an indelible mark on each and one of you. You now stand on the threshold of greatness, equipped with the foundations of exceptional leadership. Class one, you are poised to embark on your careers armed with the qualities that define the noble profession of a wildland firefighter, which are selflessness, honor, courage, compassion, loyalty, honesty, and sacrifice. You are entering a profession where you'll be called upon to put your lives on the line to protect both life and property, to be a beacon of hope on people's darkest days. In the realm of public safety, failure is not an option. You carry the weighty responsibility of upholding the trust and respect of the communities you serve. As graduates of this academy, you have achieved a significant milestone in your journey toward becoming an exemplary wildland firefighter. But remember, this success is not yours alone. It is a culmination of wavering support from families, friends, instructors, and peers. While you celebrate your accomplishments, never forget those who stood by you every step of the way. Your journey is just beginning, and the opportunities for positive impact are boundless. Take pride in your work, maintain your commitment to excellence, and never lose sight of the privilege it is to serve others in their time of need. As you chart your course forward, continue to pursue educational and professional opportunities that will enhance your skills and broaden your horizons. Your dedication and perseverance will undoubtedly yield positive results. Above all, remember these guiding principles. Express gratitude to those who have supported you. Approach each day as if it were your interview. Embrace the sense of accomplishment you feel today as fuel for your future endeavors. Never take your role for granted. Cherish the privilege of serving in the noblest of professions. Finally, know that the faculty and staff of Mt. San Antonio College stand ready to support you in your ongoing journey. Whether it's refining your resume, preparing for interviews, or securing recommendations, we are here to assist you every step of the way. Class one, congratulations once again. Stay safe in your endeavors, and may you find fulfillment as you continue to make a difference in the lives of others. Wildland Fire Academy number one, you are dismissed.